says she wanna sip, roll up, and make love tonight. But I got church in the morning, church in the morning. She says she wanna sip, roll up, and make
this
love tonight.
This is the Why Not Podcast.
But I got church in the morning, church in the morning.
Hopefully we can go to heaven. I pray. Hopefully we can go to heaven. Cause I'm safe. Hopefully we can go to heaven. I pray. Hopefully we can go to heaven. Cause I'm staying, I'm staying.
Amazing grace. It's hard to say no when it's looking so good in my face. Girl, all them curves got me on the swerve when I'm trying to drive straight. If you caught me on another day, baby girl, I probably would've took that cake. Cause every night's a birthday cake. And every time I come around, I can tell you be looking at me. And I can tell you be wondering if I'm really loving what I see. It'll be wrong if you get along, because I know me. Still, I try to be strong, say be. G on, but she ain't tryna hear me. She says she wanna sip, roll up, and make love tonight. But I got church in the morning, church in the morning. She says she
family,
wanna sip, roll
family,
up, and make love
what
tonight.
What is up? It's Teddy D back with another episode of the Why Not Podcast. As always, we appreciate the love and support. You've been reaching out at thewhynotpodcast@gmail.com. You guys have been doing a great job of going to iTunes as well, leaving some 5-star reviews. If you have not had a chance, please, please go out and do that. It helps the show in the rankings. As always, we want to give a shout out to the other support from the other show I'm a part of, the Black Astronauts Podcast. We are featured on the iTunes front page for the Black History Month. Go check us out. We're in there with some great shows that we love. So, man, much appreciated. So, today is a great show because we've been actually planning to bring this to you for at least the past, man, I don't know, 8-9 months or so. When we first had this idea, they cutting up right now. Wait till they get on the mic and it makes a lot of sense. So these are three cats that I've had the pleasure of knowing and really getting really getting close to, that we've worked together, we've hung out outside of work, and I feel like, you know, it's an extension of family. So we're gonna get into some great topics and just cut up a little bit. So I wanna go around the room and welcome three new members into the Why Not family, and of course the gentleman that I am. I want to start with the lady to my left, and she is, listen, a fitness guru, super mom, really a boss in her own right, literally and figuratively. She drives a car that's more expensive than all of ours put together, if I'm being honest. So listen, it's my homie, my little sis. What's going on?
Ladies first, I see.
Yeah.
Hello, Mr. White. Thank you for that amazing introduction.
Yeah.
I just want the world to know out there that it's very hard for me to focus as there are two wonderful gentlemen in here that are making faces and body stuff right now. Anyways, thank you for having me. I'm so delighted to be here.
Dang it. I was going to let you say your own name, man.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. This is Danette, a.k.a. Net Netter, a.k.a. Danetter, a.k.a. All that. Helen from the West End, definitely representing
the
best end, you know.
Yeah.
It's not always shown in the best light, but I'm definitely an awesome product of that environment. So
there you go.
Happy to be here and happy to be representing that.
That's what's up. So we'll make our way around. And Ned and I are the only two people in the room from the great city of Louisville, the not so great state of Kentucky. We'll branch it out a little bit and we'll go to my second hometown, a young man from the great city of Birmingham, Alabama. Really, it's funny. I didn't realize that you were from Birmingham until we got caught up one day in the break room. I was just like, what do you know about Birmingham? He's like, no, what do you know about
that's
Birmingham?
Right.
He comes to Louisville by way of being a football star. He played a couple downs back in his day when he suited up for the University of Louisville. But he's now known as a great guy in the community, involved in his church. He is a great father, funny dude. My homie, Mr. Jack. What's going on with you, brother?
What's up, everybody? How you doing?
All right, man.
This is Jack. As you said, I feel like my interview voice is not as good as yours.
Oh wow.
But yeah, I am from Birmingham, really from Fairfield, Alabama, which is a borough of Birmingham.
Right.
Next to your boy's hometown of Hueytown.
Shout out to Hueytown.
So yeah, I'm happy to
be
here.
Belma, but
Yeah, Belma. That's what we call it down there. Belma. Belma.
There you go.
Yeah. So I'm very happy to be in Louisville, man. You said the not so great state of Kentucky. I love Kentucky.
No, the great city of Louisville.
Yeah.
Not so great state of Kentucky.
I love Kentucky, man. I love Kentucky.
So shout out to my politics.
Even some of the armpit places outside of Louisville and Lexington. I love Kentucky, man. I love Louisville too, man. So I'm happy to be here.
That's what's up, man. That's what's up. So to round it out, we would have a great show with just the two of them, but we decided to call. We picked up the bat phone and we said, listen, we are going to the great state of California and we need one of your best. A young man that has been here now for a couple of years. He is a new husband, a great father. A man that is truly growing in his career and somebody who I look at is a brother and a great confidant, my dude. I'll let you go ahead and introduce your name, sir.
Appreciate you, man. Appreciate you, Teddy. It's Critch, you know.
Critch.
Hailing from the West Coast, you
That's
know.
That's what's up.
The left coast.
Yeah. You know. Yeah.
The
yeah.
best coast.
Okay.
From the Bay Area, you know, East Side San Jose. Shout out to my hometown.
Yeah.
Hey man, all glory be to God, man. I'm just really happy to be here with the, you know, people that I jig with.
Absolutely,
know?
And, man.
Yeah, shout out to the love and shout out to the followers of Christ, man.
There you go. There you go. And
I'm feeling the vibe in here right now, man.
Can you feel the love tonight?
Hey, I love how you put that Christian energy out there, too, man. I'm going to call it.
That's exactly why I can't focus.
Man, you know what?
There's nothing.
I love when a black man or a black woman or a man, period, black or white, I don't care, man. It's unafraid to say what they love and say they love Christ, man, so they love God, man. I think our youth don't see enough of that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like, I don't think too many of us grew up maybe watching our parents pray, like physically watching them pray outside of over a plate of food.
I call them closet Christians, man. The ones that, behind door and in church, they'll be Christians, man, devout. But, you know, you see them out. Don't get me wrong. We all fall short.
Right.
But we get up. Hey, man, I gotta represent my Lord and Savior, man. That's real talk.
I'm going to tell you something. I used to teach Sunday school, and I used to tell my class before I started. I used to teach the adult class in my church, and I used to tell them, look, if you see me out in the street acting the fool, he ain't through with me yet. Okay?
When they came to ask you, you're just like, you want me to teach?
Hey, don't sit up here and ordain me, man, like I'm God Almighty just because I'm teaching. No, I'm a fool just like you. I'm just trying to figure it out like everybody else. So don't put me on a pedestal.
That's what's up, man. So we... Well, like I mentioned before, we've been trying to get this show together for a while. And I mean, this is perfect how it's coming together today. And I say that because all four of us have worked not only in the same place, but in similar environments as far as work goes. And the common denominator here is that we're all of the African descent, right? African American, if you will.
Melanin.
I actually have my ancestry trace on ancestry.com. Yeah, man.
Scandinavian,
oh,
right?
Please.
Scandinavian.
Let us know what that composition is.
Yeah. Fulani.
First degree.
Fulani.
Fulani.
That sounds like one of the pillars of...
West Africa.
Nice. So like fully? So is there any other portions? Like,
well,
I found a lot of African American have Asian descent in them as well.
Well, it was more like, I want to say like 82% African and like
Irish.
Indian, and it was like, you know, surprisingly, it was like
African though.
It was like some percent white too, obviously, you know, because all of us have some white in us. Yeah. So yeah,
speak for yourself,
because this is all
only thing white on my hands and the bottom of my feet. Ash.
Shout out to Ash.
Hey, Mama. Hey, my teeth. Mama busy. Hey, my teeth and my eyes ain't even white. Both of them yellow, shoot.
Mama. I can't. So with that, being in the workplace, it's interesting because we're around the same age and we've had some, of course, differences as far as our career path, but we've also had some similarities. How do you feel, and if you don't mind, we'll start ladies first again. How do you feel, let me ask it like this. If someone asked you that isn't a person of color, like, hey, just a quick question. How do you feel going into work and just really trying to achieve and be the best that you can on a day-to-day basis? Is it any different from me? And if so, like, how? I don't understand.
Oh, my gosh.
I wish they would turn their world upside down.
Is it any different for me? Yeah, it's completely different. I kind of feel like those odds are against me every day that I walk in the door, to be completely honest with you. And more so... only because of that stereotype that's already put out there for people to know what black people are. So anytime you see us anywhere, whether it's in the workplace, outside, in the store, you're going to view me the same exact way. And even if you get to know me on a personal level, that bias that was kind of put into your head, I believe is kind of still going to be there. But it kind of all differs. But I mean, being in the workplace as a black African-American female, I've just grown to learn so much. Number one, growing in my position, as Dwight just mentioned, that, we kind of all started from the bottom. Now we're here kind of deal. But growing a lot and knowing how to move in that kind of environment around a predominantly white managed company or just country, you know what I mean? You definitely cannot, or not necessarily cannot, but you have to be so mindful of how you move about, of how you speak to people, of how you are portrayed, even your facial expressions. That's kind of one thing that I'm still working on, that if I'm having a bad day, I need to be poker face, because I am not trying to come across someone who's going to remember that I had a stank face one day if they want to potentially hire me for another position. You know, that's always going to kind of be in the back of that person's head. But absolutely, it's not the same for me as it is for you. Other person of other color skin, and I think that goes for anyone who's of other, darker pigment, that bias is always going to be there.
Okay. And it reminds me of the line from Jay's song, I'll show you how to move in a room full of vultures, which, for the record, I want to say this before we go on, we're not saying that all white people are vultures. It's not like, please don't misinterpret that.
Right.
That's not, but to acknowledge that there's no difference is to acknowledge, or not to acknowledge, the history and the culture of someone who is not the same as you,
Mm-hmm.
So I'll go around, and Jack, so I'll pose you the same question, but just in a slightly different way. What would you say to somebody who is a little younger than us, a person of color who may be fresh out of college and they're about to come into the work world as we know it, and they came to you just like, hey man, like, what, give me the rundown. What should I do?
I mean, what it all depends on the young person that I'm speaking with, because some young people don't have, I can tell that they're going to have a hard time struggling if they work in corporate America.
Yeah.
Wow.
And all of us work in corporate America.
Yeah.
And I could tell, because some young, and I don't fault them for that, because we have some young brothers that are rebels, and I do not fault them for that. It's very difficult sometimes when you are a lion, and just like Cat Williams said, you are a lion. Everything in you is saying you are a lion, but you keep looking around, you're in the zoo, and it can make you crazy sometimes. But I would tell them, this is a game, and if you want to get paid to feed your family, you have to play it. And that is just the way it is. It's very difficult to keep it real and move up in corporate America. So we all wear two faces. Every black person that works in corporate America wears two faces. There are some black people that may have grown up and they were the only black kid in their school. So it's normal to them to adapt and assimilate to that environment. Right. But for those of us like myself, I went to all black schools from kindergarten through high school, 12th grade, with no white students. And people look at me like I'm crazy when I say that, because Birmingham is a very, very...
Birmingham is a chocolate city.
It's chocolate city, man. And it's still segregated to this day, where it's economically segregated because we have neighborhood schools. So you have to go to the school in your neighborhood. Like, you can't go over to the school across the mountain with the white kids, that your parents got to pay for that.
Right. So, shout out to Jefferson County, who every year there's the debate over whether or not they should bus. And I just want to point out that... that integration was a big step that we made back in the 70s, and it needs to keep going. So shout out to all my JCPS people. Go ahead. Sorry.
But picking back on the question, I would definitely tell this young brother or young sister, go in here and focus on your work. Don't go in there playing. It's okay, but you have to network. Networking is a part of the game. It's a bigger piece of the game. It's not about what you know. It is who you know. And I will also tell them, but when you go into this work, do not lose who you are. Because one thing that a very high-ranked person at our my previous company, which is your current company, told us is that he said, look at me. I wear a $1,000 suit to work every single day. I don't have any tattoos. I have a clean cut every single day I come in here. I speak the English language better than them. And this is a black brother that I'm talking about, too. Yeah. And he said, I speak the English language better than they do. But I go into the corporate meetings with all of these big wigs and the board, and they still look at me like I'm an N-I-G-G. You fill in the blank. So, therefore, be yourself. If you have dreads, wear dreads. If you have tattoos, wear your tattoos. Yep. Because no matter what you do, they're gonna still see you as a N-I, you fill in the blank. So therefore, I try my best to be myself when I go to work. And I have to, because I'm a very big black man, so I have to, I automatically know that I have to let white people feel comfortable from the jump.
I love that.
From the jump. Because when they look at me, they're so intimidated, man. Because I don't walk in there smiling all the time, you know, because I'm not a morning person.
Yeah.
You know, but when they look at me, they're already intimidated. And when I talk, I can't lean forward when I talk to them. I have to lean back because it's intimidating. Like, white people wouldn't understand that.
Yeah.
And that's just the culture we live in, and that's part of the game.
I call that the elevator conduct for me. Like, I don't think that white women realize that I'm scared to death when they get in the elevator and it's just me. Because I'm just like, yo, let me just go ahead and break down that barrier and say, hey, how are you?
How's it going?
And your voice has to change.
Yeah, you got to get a little higher.
You got a real nice purse.
Just lean in.
I was just about to say, she's probably clutching that purse.
Right. Like, come up off that lady. But nah, man, once again, I'm quoting a lot of Rockefeller. Kanye, even when you're in the Benz, you're still a...
Exactly.
Yeah, that's real. And shout out to CY from Black Astronauts made that point as well. When we were talking about the Grammys and Kendrick Lamar. And Kendrick Lamar had that great performance, and he made the great point of saying, shout out to us being black in public. Us being black in public. Mm-hmm. You know, that's a beautiful thing, man. So to round it out, I want to go to the young homie, Mr. Critch.
Young.
So same for you, man. I'll give you the third different variation of it. If you telling your son, like, hey, here's the game as I've learned it. You just finished college. You're about to go into your new job. Like, here's what to expect and what you should do. What way are you going to push them?
You know, it's interesting because the older I get is the more my view changes. Now, for me, first and foremost, you got to understand who you are and what you look like. As Jack was saying, I too am a big black brother, and I can be intimidating. I'm also dark skinned. Mm-hmm. So to try to break down that barrier, like you were saying, Teddy, you kind of have to do that in order to kind of adapt. I was actually having this conversation with a white counterpart of mine at work the other day. And I was telling him, because what I come to realize is that we all have a certain kind of way that people view us. Even if we are white, even if we are Hispanic, what have you. Society is always going to label you. Now, what I was telling this white counterpart, I come in suited and booted every single day.
Right.
And that's a mask that I have. And I was telling them, you have to have masks. I don't care who you are. You have to have masks. And
shout out to Jim Carrey.
And shout out to Jim Carrey, you know, because he understands it better than we do.
Yeah.
But you have to have them. You have to understand which mask to put on at what time.
Exactly.
Right. And this gentleman, he always had one mask, you know, and in ways, you know, I know black folks could be envious of that, you know, because we don't have to wear or we have to have certain masks if we want to keep a job, you know, angry black man, you know, that, I mean, like Jack was saying, it's a real thing. If I come in not smiling, if I come in just quiet one day, because I'm kind of the building of the relationship type of cat, you know, I'm always cutting up and whatnot, but keeping it completely professional. But if I come in just having a quiet day,
it's a big deal to white people.
It's a big deal. Yeah. I'm angry. Hey, is everything all right?
What's wrong?
Are you good?
You seem so distant today.
Yeah,
you're so unsociable.
And that's a problem. That's a problem. However, you have this gentleman here who has the same mask that he wears at home and comes to work with. But I was explaining to him that you have to have masks. Now, to your question, what would I tell my son?
Yeah.
First and foremost, I'll tell him, son, do not label yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Because society is going to label you regardless.
Man, that's a very good point.
So don't go in there labeling yourself and saying, you know, I'm this and I'm that. I'm a black man. Woo, woo, woo. You know, because, yes, I'm living this experience as a black man from what society is telling me. However, to my point at the beginning, I'm a follower of Christ, man, and so my black flesh is just flesh. It'll perish with this earth. But my spirit and my soul is going to be with my Father. Right. And that's the most important thing that you can hold on to. If society did not label each individual, imagine the prosperity each and everyone would have.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But we don't live in a perfect world. So, son, know who you are. Know what you look like. But you have to approach every situation as an interview. That's how I do it. I approach every single situation as an interview because I have no idea who's watching.
Right.
And I want to make sure I'm putting my, especially in the workplace, I'm putting my best foot forward just in case, you know, head honcho's watching. You know, somebody, I was telling this to a colleague of mine too. I'm suited and booted because you know what? Somebody, it's all about perception, right?
Right.
Somebody can have different perceptions of however you're doing, right?
Yeah, perception is reality.
And it's their reality. It's not your own. It's their reality. No. So if their perception is, man, you a lazy son of a gun, you know? And then they go to my boss and say, yeah, Terrence, he's lazy. He don't get nothing done. They go look at it and say, Terrence.
Who's Terrence?
Who's Terrence? You talking about Critch?
Yeah.
Oh, you can't be talking about Critch. And because they're gonna say Critch, man, he always comes to work super suited and booted.
Right.
He's always super professional. Nah, you ain't talking about Critch.
Right.
Matter of fact, I was just gonna promote Critch because of how he carries himself. So it's all about masks that we wear, but I mean, you just gotta know oneself, man. And don't label yourself. It's like crabs in a bucket, man. I'm sorry. I'm just gonna say it. Black folks, we have it's an epidemic in our community that we are crabs in a bucket and we continue to pull each other back as opposed to uplift each other. And
it's self-hate.
It's self-hate. Yeah. And it's been,
I meant to tell you I hate you too, but go ahead.
I feel you. I hate your, I hate my black lips.
I hate the black around your neck.
Nah, but it is. It's self-hate, man. And it's a brilliant concept because it was taught. And now, guess who's doing the teaching?
Yeah.
Ourselves. Yeah. The houses that don't have fathers in it. What are we teaching? Be absent. We don't need to be there with one another. And it's self-hate. And we gotta stop. We gotta start uplifting. If you see a brother over there, you know, speaking eloquently, you know, with the soliloquies and
metaphor.
But don't sit
My
there
brother.
And throw him down, though. You know what I'm saying? Uplift that brother because he's trying to uplift himself. We have to look. We come in different shapes, forms, backgrounds, we have to start understanding that. We have to accept that, man.
That's a great point, Jay.
Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, you know, that's a great point that you make, because that is exactly what I've struggled with all my entire life. Like I said, I hail from the West End, all black people, low income black people. Mm-hmm. My mother was someone who was always working. So, you know, she was never really in the home. So we had to find our own way. And so with that being, you know, I grew up as a very mature and very aware of the world and very aware of what was going on. So with that, you know, and talking about the busing system, you know, that worked out for the best way in me, because mm-hmm. being bused out to these predominantly white neighborhoods and suburbs, I was exposed to things that I typically may not have been. And so instead of, you know, kind of falling into that trap and hanging with all the hood people, I was playing the violin and I was in, you know, advanced courses and stuff.
You played violin?
Yes, I did.
Hey, I'm gonna jump in on that. Go, girl. I did.
I played the flute. Do not judge.
But kind of what comes, kind of comes with. You guys are crazy. But no, seriously, what kind of comes with that education is a different form of the way you speak. And like you said, like you know, that person at Humana, that very high up person, you know. Once you start speaking in this way, like you're presenting yourself like, oh my God, this is an intelligent black person. Yeah. But what did I get though from my black people? You talk like a white girl. Yeah. You know what I mean? I'm like, I'm from the hood. I still reside in the hood, actually. Yeah. Yeah. But yet, because I speak properly, I talk like a white girl, and that is almost like a insult to oneself.
But who is it? Exactly.
That is an insult to mm-hmm. that person, saying mm-hmm. that white people talk "quote unquote" smarter because that's what they're saying. And then since I'm not dumbing myself down to kind of make you feel more comfortable or actually make you understand what I'm saying, mm-hmm. because I'm using words that are actually in the dictionary, you know what I mean? They do put
you
down to.
But I mean, they couldn't find it even if they looked, even if they had a dictionary.
Also, you know, we also say that you're talking white, but white people in America don't talk English properly.
Absolutely.
If you go to Europe, you know, they sound totally different, you know, speaking the English language, you know. I really think there's like two problems in that story, too. You know, the one thing is that the self-hate of I'm telling you that you're talking white. And this is my opinion. I think that the brothers have it harder than the sisters, you know, because the sisters, I don't know how it is being a sister in America, but I know when you are a brother in America, man, and you try to speak properly and carry yourself in a better way, man, it is more difficult. Like, you catch hell, man, from your other counterparts, mm-hmm. you know, especially as a teenager. But I have been very fortunate, man, to grow up in a pro-black house, you know, like very pro-black. My mother worships Angela Davis, you know, and we grew up where black is so beautiful. I had black figurines everywhere, so it was naturally
instilled. I got them black angels, too.
Yeah, black angels, man. Yeah. Black Santa Claus.
She calls them niggerines.
Black Jesus.
Niggerines.
Black Jesus, too.
Exactly. Black Jesus, man. Black
That's
everything.
That's real.
But it's just something that is instilled in you as a youth. And I really think, man, when it comes to our kids, man, you know, like, we really got to let them fly, too, because one thing I learned when I was growing up is that my dad used to talk to me so much, man, about blah, 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 blah. And I thought that he was just like, this dude is crazy. He keeps repeating his stories, how we talked about it earlier. He keeps saying the same story over again. I'm like, dude, you told me this already.
He'd be like, come here, son, let me talk to you.
But as I get older, I am so lucky and fortunate to have that, because now I have two boys now. I have a 5-year-old and a 1-year-old, and I'm talking to my 5-year-old. Like, I'm talking to him about life, you know, and how important it is to be himself and be a good friend to his friends. You know, and then I'm giving him a speech, and he turns to me and says, what? Can we go to All About Kids? like literally didn't think. Like,
you know, that's a good point because, I mean, that's one reason why I brought Cub here. Because he sees
me. I think that's
so
good too, man.
Yeah, he sees me as, you know, probably a drill sergeant father that's always talking to him, cut up with him, you know.
You are a drill sergeant, man. I want to point that out. I love it though, man.
You see how mild mannered he is. But I mean, I brought him here so he can see those masks that I was talking about, mm-hmm. because you have to have them. It's cool to cut up, man. It's cool. But you got to understand, this was one thing my father, and praise God I have my father, man, you know, because coming from San Jose, California, you could get wrapped up in anything and everything, man. Mm-hmm. Everything is available to you. Fortunately for me, I had a hero that raised me. And I was able to see what a man is supposed to emulate and how he's supposed to walk and how he's supposed to talk. Right. And so, you know, fortunate for me, it was passed on to me. So he always taught me, son, you have to know when and where to play. You have to know how to talk to such and such. You have to know the etiquette no matter what situation you're in. You could be at a dinner party and you got 7 different kinds of forks and 4 different kinds of spoons, you know. Or you could be just talking to homeboy up the street.
Right. For the record, just eat from the outside in.
There you go.
I have no idea how to do that.
Thank you for that tip, because I had no idea.
But my father prepared me for that. And now I find myself, you know, it, with my position, my job, I'm having dinner with people that are all from different walks of life and different parts of the world. And we are having this fancy dinner. And I can now understand the etiquette that I'm supposed to pretty much just have respect for myself in all situations.
Because you got to look good if you're going to order the ribeye.
I'm just saying.
You can't be eating a steak with a salad fork.
So I can order anything? I can get the fish?
I can get that malt liquor?
How much for one rib? Man,
that's what it's like.
Your finger.
But I mean, that's some great points that you all make. And I find myself in a different position because, you know, I am a single mother. And I don't have that. I don't have any kind of, besides the friends that I know that he sees that are excellent role models for a young black man. He doesn't have anyone, even the 6 brothers that his father's side has. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, but hey, keep it real. But there's nothing for him to look up to emulate. So, you know, kind of that's one of my fears is having that.
And I'm glad you brought him here today.
So, you know, but still, that does not mean that I'm not schooling him, because, you know, just as all you are talking about, being a black person, just being black already puts a target on your back. And I was watching this video, and I think I shared it with Critch over there. Dr. Joy DeGruy, she was giving this presentation to a predominantly white room and trying to explain to them how white racism and black racism is not, absolutely not the same thing. Give me some examples of how white racism affects black people. The room is silent. Mm. Give me some examples of how white racism affects black people economically, socially. Yeah. I mean, if you can change the living conditions, the actual quality of life for another race, that is something that is completely different. So,
we got threw off, so we got a giggle right now.
Sorry about that. Got a little extra going on.
But going back to what you said, I think I know who that person is you're speaking of. And I saw one presentation that she had where she was in an auditorium, you know, full of people. And it appeared that she was giving a presentation for a corporation. And they were trying to, it seemed to have ethnic, you know, race training or something like that. You know, that's what it appeared in that video I saw. Yeah. And she asked them, how many of you would trade places with a black person for one day? Raise your hand. And everybody looked around and sat back in their seat like, shoot.
Get saved.
Yeah, so I was just making sure you're on your P's and Q's.
I got you,
curse on the microphone.
I got you.
But I mean, I don't want to beat on the dead horse of this, but it's just one of those things that, you know, I think as far as your son, when you're talking about as a young man, even though I had my dad in my house, I didn't emulate my dad growing up.
Yeah.
I looked to other outside men to emulate, you know, because my dad and I bumped heads so much when I was growing up. You know, I love my dad, you know, but we're so much alike, we bump heads sometimes. And I was fortunate to play a lot of sports, and I emulated a lot of my coaches and a lot of my friends' parents, you know, like they would their dads, you know, but I would emulate my dad sometimes. But as a kid growing up, you know, you're like, I don't want to be anything like them when I have kids, and when I have kids, I'm not going to do that. I mean, my kids Hindsight's 20/20. Now that I have kids, man, you might as well just strap some overalls on me because I act just like my dad. I act just like him.
You know, it's
and
funny.
I'm proud to act like him because he is the number one man. Yeah. I mean, I just like give him so much praise, man, you know, for like the way that he conducted himself.
Well, I'll say this too, and that's a great point that Nat made, that man, there are so many not only single mothers but just women holding it down.
Yeah, absolutely.
Incredibly well.
Absolutely.
Incredibly well.
Man, we gotta step our game up, man.
Yeah, well,
shout out to my ex-wife. You holding it down, girl.
Real time.
I gotta give her credit. And also, I want to point something out too, because I know a lot of people hopefully will be listening to this.
Yep.
If you are a man and you are not with the mother of your kids,
okay,
and if the mother of your kids is an awesome mother, call and or text her and tell her that.
Yeah,
because she needs that, and she wants to hear it from you and not anybody else. Because
it's not normal.
So, brothers,
you shout out to the single fathers, too, though.
And also, this is for the women, because everybody who knows me, I would let the women have it and let them know about themselves. Mm. Now, I ain't saying I'm a woman hater, but I will speak the truth.
He-Man woman hater.
Yeah, He-Man woman hater. But I will speak the truth, because there are a lot of women out there who...
Wretched.
They get women get passes in America. Uh-oh. You know, they really do. And this is going to go down a whole other subject path. But women get passes in America.
How so?
I'm trying to keep it PG on here right now, man. I'm trying to keep it PG in here right now.
You got a vocab. You can do it.
Well, let's say a woman can get a pass acting the fool at work, being emotional.
Okay.
You know, just hysterically just going off on everybody.
Yeah.
But men don't get that pass at work.
No, because it's scary.
You're fired.
It's scary to them.
Yeah. You know, men don't get that pass at work. That's a mild example.
Sure.
You know, but also the women, I really want to just going back to what I was talking about. Yeah. The women, if you have a man that is the father of your kids and he is doing a great job and he is a great father. Tell him, text him, or call him. Just because you all are not together, I recently contacted my ex-wife, and at first I was all against this. I ain't calling her. I can't stand her right now.
Right.
But then after I sat back and thought about it, I said, man, I am so blessed to have this woman that's the mother of my children.
Yeah.
Because every time I see my kids, they are well taken care of. You know, they are into the church. You know, they love people. You know, they listen well. They mind well. Mm-hmm. And I give all that credit to her. And I felt good after I did
Take some credit, dog. Take some credit.
Well, it's a team effort.
It is.
It's a team effort, man. And I think that that's an important. And you know what? On the side note, I just want to shout out to Young Nat, man. There's a couple of guys that really been looking forward to hearing from you. So, you might want to tell them hi.
Single and mingling.
There you
just
go.
Saying, hey, there is an application process. Just want to say, if you go to www.youngnet.com, then, you know, we can get the process started.
It's funny Credit how women list. It's funny how the woman's list is so long about what they want in a man.
You know what, though?
Oh,
man?
Let's go there.
But he has to have a job. I like him tall.
I don't
like skinny man. I like him dark. I don't like crusty feet. You know, he has to be lotion.
But I got
Thank you,
Grinch.
Because
I was gonna say,
I like the hair.
When I was younger, my list was longer, though. You know what I'm saying? Like, let me say that.
Very long.
Big booty. Everybody's gotta have a big booty, but it's gotta be real.
So
no
petty.
Fake booties. No,
she got a big booty, so I name a big booty.
Right?
I had this thing against knock-kneed women.
Really?
Like, I used to date a woman back in college. We didn't really
He likes them bow-legged, by the way.
I used to mess with a girl back in college, man, and she was so beautiful, smart, you know, she was...
But not
I'm not gonna say what school she was in college, because I don't want to, because that might give her away. She was on her way to making some money.
Okay,
you know? So
there you go.
So I was thinking about, man, she's smart. She's on a good path. You
she was
know,
an art student,
she
right.
was beautiful. She was all. She treated me like a king, but I couldn't get past when she was in the mirror how I saw the knees almost touching.
Really? That's what stopped you,
I'm
bro.
Done.
And
I'm
it
done.
And it was and it told me, man, she is all there, but I cannot get past. It's almost like Eddie Murphy.
If we walking down,
it's almost like Eddie Murphy.
Petty Tendergrass, right here. Petty Tendergrass.
He pulled those sheets back and saw it was hammer time. And he could not handle it. I used to be petty like that, man. I used to have a list where my woman had to have little feet, you know, like I didn't want a big foot woman. And I said a size 9.5 or shorter. I didn't want a tall woman. She got to be 5'5".
Yeah, my mom was supposed to do
that. And women, though, right?
I wear an 11 in women, but that's because I'm 5'10".
Yeah.
I'm a tall girl. Hey, shout out to the 5'10 and up club.
Tall women have a harder time, in my opinion.
Oh, gosh, yes, we do.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, and especially, you know, kind of circling back to the workplace, you know, and speaking
with
women
checking their kids.
And then kind of I had the amazing opportunity to speak with Critch's mom, mm-hmm. who's mm-hmm. definitely a great mentor. She's
shout
incredibly intelligent, PhD, doctor, actually.
Okay, we throwing out.
And but kind of one of the things she told me, you know, in some of my conversations with her, is about
your
being
paper,
tall.
Girl.
Yeah, it's about being tall. But, you know, it's a hindrance, but it's an advantage as well, because you know it precisely, you know, mm-hmm. they see me taller, they kind of they look to those people where you can act literally look up to, and you know you heard a certain kind of degree of you can make stuff move, basically. Right. I can come in there and command the room, command the attention
to you, and you can be more assertive. I mean,
absolutely
you take control of a room.
Right. Definitely. So it does. But as far as dating, I'm just telling. Sometimes I got to tell these dudes, you got to be this tall to ride this ride. But no, I'm joking. I kind of heard that. That was the kind of little corny joke. Right. There you go. But
you know what though,
it is hard.
They be looking like dang.
It is hard because you know, like being 5'10", it's almost 6 feet tall. So like, how many? That the average man is 6 foot tall, so like, you know, come
no,
on.
That's
no,
not
he's
true.
Not
5'10".
Oh, is he? The average man's 5'10".
So
hey,
in this room is above average.
So hey,
actually, you know what? I can't speak for them, but I am.
2 inches from the floor.
From the floor.
Oh God!
You better not. Go. You better not edit that out. You gotta let the world know the brothers, ladies, the brothers are. Packing.
You know I guess.
Oh my gosh! And they mean right, 22
PG,
pistols.
PG. PG.
All the caliber.
22 pistols.
But yeah, man, I have a niece, man, and she is gonna be tall.
Yeah,
you know. She's about 12 or 13 years old. Her dad is 6'6", 6'7".
Oh, yeah.
My sister is 5'10", 5'9", 5'10".
Yeah.
And she is already 5'10", 5'11".
Wow.
And she's 12. And she's growing.
How about that?
And she's growing.
All the way till 18.
All of her uncles are over 6'2". You know, like, and so she's, and she's got uncles on her dad's size at 6'6", you know, 6'5", 6'7", things like that. So, and I worry about her sometimes, you know, because tall women have such a hard time in this world.
Right.
And I...
Volleyball.
What'd you say?
Volleyball. Who was the athlete that said, I don't want my daughter playing basketball because I don't want her...
Wearing those tight shorts?
Nah, I don't want her basketball because I don't want her...
Oh, being, to be a lesbian.
To be a lesbian.
Who said that?
I can't remember. Did y'all hear about that?
But you know what, though? I hear that so much from women. It's mostly women, you know, because men, I know a lot of men who don't have sons, and first thing they do is put a ball in their daughter's hand, you know, because they especially because all of my friends play sports, so naturally they're going to, you know, bring their kids and introduce them to sports. So... But the mother is the one that's hesitant to put them in basketball because it's for that number one reason. They say, I don't want her to be a lesbian.
See, that's crazy to me, though, because I know plenty of women basketball players.
Who are not lesbian.
That are not.
Yeah.
Shout out to Storm from the Hoopla podcast out of L.A., man.
Hey, you know what?
You know?
If you don't mind, man, I just kind of take over
right
for
ahead.
A second.
Go right ahead.
The putting balls in the
balls.
Arm.
Pause.
Sorry.
And, sorry.
Were you going to say putting balls in the hands of our daughters?
Right? Yes,
no,
was.
No, listen. What I was going to say is what you said to me kind of sparked something.
No one in the room has a daughter, for the record.
it sparked something to me because Jack and I were actually very, very blessed and fortunate to be a part of Tie Day at Thomas Jefferson Middle School.
Exactly.
And and it was such a blessing to me, because what it was
to the listeners that may not know what
Exactly. Thank you. What it was they were trying to get a group of men from the community they tried to get 100. I believe 85 ended up showing up to teach these young men, over 400 young men, middle school age, to tie ties. Mm-hmm. And you know, and it's in the inner city, you know, these inner city kids or whatnot. And it was such a blessing for me. But one thing that stuck out to me was when the principal asked, that he was facing these kids on one side of the gym. He asked, he said, "How many of y'all aspire to be a professional athlete?"
Yeah.
And pretty much everybody's
all their hands went up.
And I turned to my homeboy, I said, "See, that's the problem." Because all we have in the black community, all we allow to have, are these
rapping, singing.
But what do they all do?
Dancing,
athletes. Dancing. All of them are entertainers. All of them shook and jive. Exactly. All of them.
Exactly.
The ball players too. They all entertainers, and it's like Gladiator, right? You put them in the ring and just entertain us,
right?
But that's all we aspire to be, because that's all we see. And so it was such a blessing to me to be able to be a part of that as a professional brother that always I try to hold myself to the highest esteem, and be surrounded with so many prestigious men, brothers. And it was all colors and races and all that.
Yes.
Kids and the men. However, we need to start.
We must could need it, maybe.
We need to really
mama,
start to
mama business.
I'll wait. Now we really need to start to get to our kids, man, and let them understand, man, there is, I'm sorry, but there's no value. There's value in athletics, right? Yeah. Because athletics, I grew up in athletics, and it taught me a whole lot. There's value in that, you know, to be a competitor, to be a warrior, you know,
and team player,
and socialize and all that. However, we need to get into our communities and start teaching these young boys and young women that, listen, you don't need to be an entertainer to get ahead, because literally, that's all they know. That's all they see. They need to dance. They need to shook and jive. They need to shoot a basketball. But real talk, I know this is super cliche, right? But real talk, the doctors, the nurses, the lawyers, the chemists, the botanists. I mean, there's so many more things that we can choose from.
But see, that's something that is kind of when, I'm going to give you an example. When I came to college, and I was very fortunate to come out with no student loans. And I came to college, and when I was 18, they asked me, "What do you want to major in?" And I paused for a second, as I had no idea what I wanted to major in. I had no idea. I believe most kids that go to college, they have no idea what they want to do. And when the thing about sports is, I don't think wanting to aspire to be an athlete or an entertainer is a negative thing. Because I say shoot for the stars if you're going to do it.
Right.
You know, because these kids know they make the most money, you know, and these kids know that everybody loves them and wants to be them. Look at Cam Newton. This dude took dabbing to a whole nother level.
That's amazing.
You know, and the thing about it is that everybody wants to be these people, and who doesn't want to be that person, you know, that wants to be loved by everybody. But coming from a house where my mom told me, "Okay,
like,
I understand you're good at sports."
Say it like that.
"I understand you're good at sports, but you need a plan B." I understand you want to go to the NFL, but you are going to have a plan B if you're going to be in my house.
That's,
you
know, real quick, the thing though.
Plan B, you got to get that at Planned Parenthood.
Shut up. But no, seriously, I think that I think that those inner city kids, like you just mentioned, kind of playing, going back to what he said, you know, it's not a negative thing, but if you don't have anything else to aspire to, then you don't know. Like, they don't have those resources down there for, you know, the kids in the West End or the kids in the inner city or low income families. They are not exposed to those kind of opportunities. So how would they ever even know to aspire to be those kind of things? Because all they have in front of them, all they are being pushed and exposed to, is, you know, music and dabbing and all that, and especially because dabbing is smoking the oil, right? So, like, it's not only that, like, this guy, he put it to the next level, but you know, the actual
people
meaning behind
no
it. They don't.
The origin
they
of
don't. They have no idea.
And it weighs
no
on
idea.
The subconscious, too. I mean, I'm a
because
believer
we,
of subconscious.
Because we know what it means. Yeah.
Right, right, right. But, I mean, it's like when we grew up. When we grew up to these cartoons where they had, you know, these explicit little behind-the-scenes meanings, you know what I'm
like
saying?
Like Pepe Le Pew was a rapist.
Hey, man. Real talk.
And Speedy Gonzalez was a drunk Hispanic. Like, I mean, it's all...
I'm saying it pre...
Falcor, Leghorn? Like, it keeps going.
Hey,
it goes,
you know
dog.
What?
Falcor?
Foghorn, my dude. Foghorn.
Oh, I thought you were talking about the big long dragon from the Never Ending Story.
From the Never Ending Story, I'm with you on that.
Because I was thinking that could be subliminal, you know, to ask the young brothers like riding the long penis.
You know what?
Okay.
Exactly. Well, you know what?
One fish, two fish.
That is a perfect segue to say that is exactly why the mentality is the way it is of the majority of the society. Because, like, just like the cigarette commercials, you know, they would show these huge rocks, which was supposed to be symbolic of a phallus, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So you see this big rock, smoke cigarettes, and you'll have you know what I mean? Yeah. And kind of going back to what we were talking about, all this propaganda, it is very intentionally being put into the community so that kids and even adults will perform and act in a certain way.
Step out of the matrix.
Yes.
Do not take the blue pill.
Or maybe it was the red pill.
Yeah, I took the blue pill.
Okay, it was the blue pill. Okay. Rabbit hole.
Y'all are
trying to see. I had the blue pill.
And you see why.
College boy.
Just by listening to this show, we were always late coming back from break.
Always. I mean, the conversation can never end.
That
we can
really,
talk about this
really,
all
really can.
This
man.
Is the song that never ends.
I hope I'm doing my mama proud.
Absolutely, man. I want to wrap up real quick by giving you guys a chance to shout out anybody that you want. Show some love.
Is it over?
Hey, man.
Oh, man, I want to do more.
It's just a start, though. It's just a start.
Well, it's because somebody has to leave at 11:30. I don't want to point any fingers. Actually, 10:30. They haven't leave at 10:30.
So start out with
I'll
you,
go ahead.
Man.
I appreciate you, man. Yeah, real talk. I want to shout out to all my people back home and in the Bay Area. You know, I reside in Indiana now, and that's my home now. But sure. You know, I built my roots. But shout out to my wife, man.
Shout out.
Real talk. She holds it down.
I like the way you did that. That was great.
She holds it down for me, man.
This is Crit.
Yeah, this Crit. And you know what, man? To God be all the glory, man. Yep. She's brought me so much closer to Christ, baby. I love you, and I'm coming home.
You know what? Don't do that on the mic. Hey, mute.
To put the hem on you.
Because you want to improve the home. Go ahead. Go right ahead. So,
this is a Jack, man. I just want to give a shout out to everybody in Fairfield, Alabama. Everybody down in Birmingham, Alabama. Everybody riding up I-65 to Louisville. Everybody in Louisville. Yeah, I want to, you know, my kids, you know, hopefully one day they'll listen to this when they get older, you know, because one thing about these things, they're like time capsules. And as long as the internet isn't tampered by the government, they'll be able to step
That's
in.
That's Jack.
And,
Jack said
and,
that.
Yeah, and hey, I said it. As long as the internet is not tampered, they're already trying to tamper our cell phones with the Apple issue. You know, and that's a whole nother combo.
The show, man.
But I want to, you know, shout out to my girl. She out there having a ladies' weekend with her girls. You know who you are. And because I don't want your coworkers to know that you are with a dude like me, so I ain't going to say your name.
Oh, my God.
Because you might get fired. You know, they were like, you with that militant boy. But I just want to state, like, thank you, Teddy, man. For bringing me in here. I want to give a shout out to you, man. It was a great opportunity, a great experience.
Of course,
I hope I don't sound too good. This is my first time doing the podcast. Hey, I was hella nervous. Sweat running down my back. I was like, dude, man, I hope I'm not like
his gorilla like, back.
Yeah. Big silverback gorilla. Mama. No, mama.
He walked in here on his knuckles.
See you later.
All right, man, I'm done, man.
Oh gosh.
You my homie, though.
I love it. I just want to say, you know, Danette's always moving with the big dogs, you know what I mean?
With the big dogs.
Hey, I'm definitely such a tomboy, and I feel my most comfortable when I'm with my dudes, you know what I mean? For sure. Not to, you know, downplay my girls, but don't have many of those.
But you
anyways,
suck.
Anyways, shut your mouth. I'm just kidding.
Talking about the girls.
Very serious.
Damn.
Anyways, thank you. Mute Terrence, please. Critch. Oops. I'm just kidding.
You're gonna get fired tomorrow.
Okay. So my shout outs are excuse me, you're being rude. No, definitely shout out to Dwight here. Teddy.
It's all good. It's all right.
Government.
They know who you are.
Yeah, they know who you are.
They're watching you now.
I know. I'm like exposing everybody in this room. They're going to be like coming after us because of the content of our conversation. Yeah. But anyways, definitely shout out to Teddy Pendergrass here. Yeah. and also, again, shout out to the West Side. Shout out to all those single mothers doing their thing. They're representing. They're in the corporate workplace. They are carrying themselves very well, very highly, with just a nice, beautiful, beautiful decorum. Shout out to my best friend, Dominique.
Domo.
I'm going to shout her out. She did just have a baby.
She had the baby.
Beautiful girl. Congratulations.
She is
beautiful
gorgeous.
Girl.
Shout out to Jen being a big sis.
Yes, and her name is Egypt. Nice, so man. Definitely going along with the nice theme there. She's definitely an inspiration too. She's a commercial pilot. Yeah. She's another African-American female who is standing up and showing this world exactly what we're doing. And I'm making extra background noise. But yes, shout out to my family, my mother. She is my backbone. She has taught me everything. Thing. She was a single mother as well. And I really love her. I love all my family. Shout out to my sister down in Decatur, Georgia. I love you so much. I love all my nieces and nephews. I have 12 of them. And I'm trying to wrap it up here. They're like giving me the stank eye. No, I'm kidding. But I just appreciate this opportunity to be here. And I would love, love, love to come back.
Oh,
there's the music. You know, when you hear the music,
I've got one more shout out. Shout out to all the girls who washed the back of their neck.
Hey, that oil be creeping back down there. That perm.
Ladies, wash the back of your neck.
And behind your ears, too.
Behind your ears, you know.
You never understood as a kid why they told you. Bad experience. Like, a girl, I won't even name her, but like,
please don't.
Oh,
it can bad. Smell y'all should see horrible. Her face. Y'all should see horrible. Teddy's face right now.
It can be bad.
It's going to be some ladies, who is Jack and who he talking about? Watch behind their back. And you the one with a dirty
you
neck.
You the one that has that neck that smells like a belly button.
You gotta ask.
Oh my gosh, not a belly button.
Last thing I'll do, if you guys don't mind, is we have two more guests in the room. No. Let's go ahead and bring them up. They've been doing a really good job of trying to stay quiet and do their thing. I want to give them a chance to shout out. We'll start with Young Deuce. What's up, man? How you doing?
Good.
All right. So you guys having a good time?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. So what are you about to go somewhere, aren't you?
No.
No.
Really?
Okay, starting with the second one. What's your name, sir?
Martez.
Hey, Tez. You having fun today, man?
Yeah, yo.
That's my dog.
What do you
want
to say?
All right.
I want to say Mama and my friend is cool.
Ah, that's the best.
I love you, baby.
Martez and Deuce. And Deuce, you want to say anything?
No. What? Really?
Martez, what else you want to say? You want to say anything else?
I want to say Mama and you and you.
You want to say hi to anyone?
Yeah.
I want to say hi to my everyone.
Oh, all right. Everybody says hi to you, man.
Yeah.
Everybody says hi to you. You want to spit some bars? No? Okay.
Oh, right. Tell me a rap. Oh, you do?
All right.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Oh.
No.
Bebop. Oh, yeah. Oh. On the microphone. On the microphone. Getting it.
Go, Martin.
Go, Ted.
Go, Ted.
Go, Ted. Hey. Hey.
Good job, buddy. Good job.
With Jack in the background.
Somebody.
Deuce, you want to say hi to anybody?
Really? Yes.
Who you want to say hi to, man?
everybody.
Oh, you guys are the best. Really? You guys are the best. Oh,
thanks for hopping on.
I love it. All right. Well, as always, you can reach us at thewhynotpodcast@gmail.com. This has been another one. We appreciate everybody for coming out. And please get at us. Leave a 5-star review on iTunes. Listen to the Black Astronauts Podcast. Support everyone who's in the SYO, from Cali to Baltimore to Texas. All of you, we appreciate it. And we'll get to y'all next week.
A word with the word came to me, the sweetness of a honeycomb tree. And now I look what's taking over me. Couldn't fake it if I wanted to. I had to wake up just to make it through. I got my patience and I'm making it. I learned my lessons from the ancient roots. I choose to follow what the greatest do. A bird with a word came to me, the sweetness of a honeycomb tree. And now I look what's taking over me. Couldn't fake it if I wanted to. I had to wake up just to make it through. I got my patience and I'm making do. I learned my lessons from the ancient roots. I choose to follow what the greatest do. I'm repping for the longest cycle. My uncles had to pay the cost. My sister used to sing to Whitney. My mama caught the gambling bug. We came up in a lonely castle. My papa was behind them bars. We never had to want for nothing. Said all we ever need is love. We see the same thing. We sing the same song. We feel the same grief. Bleed the same blood. You grew up in the home beside me. I always had a friend to call. How could I make it here without you? I pray I leave before you go. A bird with a word came to me. The sweetness of a honeycomb tree. And now I look what's taking over me. Couldn't fake it if I wanted to.